Hello, everyone. This talk is not, strictly speaking, about Gentoo, but it is about related issues, software, and infrastructure. So I'd like to discuss issues of live data synchronization, what we have at our university in Moscow, and how we solved this. What task do we have? We have to deploy multiple high availability and load balancing clusters for various issues like hosting, voice IP, and other corporate services, as well as we need fast data synchronization for HPC systems, and of course we need to backup all of this stuff. That's quite simple task as it sounds, but we have some very tightly limited hardware resources. So we have to pack a lot of, for example, LXC containers in several hosts and manage all this effectively. This is how our infrastructure looks like. We have multiple nodes, and all of them are combined into several rings. Each ring contains of master and slave nodes, which have availability switched one from another, and backed up. So in order to implement this infrastructure, we need to perform file-level synchronization between host file systems. Of course, for databases, other mechanisms are used. For example, for MySQL-like databases, we are using Percona solutions for now. So how do we implement file-level synchronization from one host to another? There are possible solutions for this task. We looked through over them. There are read-only file systems, but that's a very limited use case. It's not a general solution. Block replication devices can be used, but on one gigabit per second connections, they are too slow and not usable in our case. The same network file systems like CF are not usable because latencies are too high and we have low latency demanding applications. So we applied for file level replication where one node and one directory replicates to another. Before writing some new software, it's always a good idea to look what exists in the world. Maybe you don't need to write it, and there is something that matches, that fulfills your needs. The best match for our task is LSyncD, live synchronization daemon. It does in its idea what we need, but it has following problems. It has high CPU load because crucial parts are written in low code, and LUA is quite slow in some cases. When, for example, from 8 cores on a system, we have 2 of them loaded by file-level synchronization, this is unacceptable. Also, there is no threading support, which we need for huge directories with millions or even dozens of millions of objects, like huge websites, for example. There are limitations for file-level aggregation, and there's no support for load and shared objects, which perform tasks that we need. There's no support for BSD systems, and we'd like to have one. Other solutions are just from another areas. For example, in cron daemon, it has no recursion and no events. It just calls synchronization handler for each event. This is not good for our task. SyncD is also sync2 is also quite slow, and we have to develop something of our own. This is a principal schema of how clsync software works. This is a daemon which utilizes a kernel monitor subsystem. This subsystem monitors event on the file system and notifies daemon of any changes, for example, file creation, deletion, changes, and so on. These changes are aggregated and then passed to a handler. Handler can be everything. The most often used case is rsync application, but well, it can be just anything. Now I'd like to discuss monitoring subsystem tools. Linux kernel provides several possible infrastructures, so we have to define which one to use for our needs. The first one historically is denotify. It is a fully functional infrastructure. It can trace any file system event, but it have a lot of drawbacks. For example, individual files can be monitored. Only directories can be monitored and denotified, and on any change in directory, event will be generated. All unmount procedures are blocked. So if you are monitoring, for example, some remotely connected device via iSCSI, you cannot unmount it as long as it has been monitored. And notification is signal-based. Because it is signal-based, that's quite slow and inconvenient way. Only one number can be passed. It's a file descriptor, so this requires a lot of start system calls. So denotify works, but it's just too slow and inefficient. iNotify is our choice for this task. It's EPOL-based notification. EPOL allows you to just register a callback function. Thank you. And it is much faster and much efficient, but it has drawbacks as well. It provides no recursion. So if you want to monitor a large directory, you have to recursively dip into each subdirectory. And this makes coding complicated. And one have to map manage a map between iNotify watches for an object being watched and a real path for a file or directory. These maps are not maintained by the kernel. There is a newer notification file system, HA Notify. It has recursion support. It's very efficient. It returns file descriptor as well as PID of the process. But it has one serious issue. It can't handle events such as file deletions or moves or renames. This happens because FA Notify works with file descriptors. So when a file is moved, this event is not handled. And unfortunately, due to this, we can't just use it. There's no way. And since we have some hosting on BSD systems, we were thinking about how to implement the stuff in BSD. It's not that easy because BSD kernel does not provide iNotify subsystems that Linux kernel has. And there is nothing really good compared to iNotify. There is a CACU subsystem, but it's very slow and efficient, but probably it's the best that we have. There is also a libiNotify project, but it's just a wrapper around CACU, which allows to mimic Linux interface. Unfortunately, libiNotify is extremely buggy at this moment. There is a BSM API. It's similar to Linux Audit API, so monitoring file events is not its original purpose, but with some tricks and can be used for this. And there is a detrace subsystem, but it's just unusable because BSD implementation is limited and file paths can be extracted. So CoQueue is used as a best match possible. So how clsync works? Firstly, it initializes, reads all its rule, regular expressions that it descends into subdirectories, setting all identify watches, performs full tree synchronization. If new events were coming while tree was synchronized, it performs resynchronization until there are no new events. And while it then waits as a daemon, aggregate events, and performs previous step. So what can be a handler? clsyncd is only a daemon, right? So it doesn't do any action on file modifications. It just notifies, runs your handler. Simple handler is used primarily for debugging. It just calls for each event handler provided. Direct handler calls any application directly you want to call. Shell is designed to call shell wrappers. For example, if one needs to have some special work with return calls. Rsync direct is handler for direct rsync calls. Rsync shell is a wrapper for rsync management. And we have two very interesting modes: rsync shared object, rsync SO, and SO modes. They allow to write your own shared object in C or any language that can support callback function from C, and your function just gets a list, prepared list for notification, list of files changed, and you can do with this list whatever you want. This is very fast and efficient way. For example, we handle changes on our IPC, on our HPC hosts this way. So, since we manage infrastructure quite massive, security is important here because we have sensitive services, personal data, and so on. So we took care about handling and hardening security of this application. We use the following technologies. Optionally, they can be engaged, like privilege dropping, using of capabilities, isolation by namespace or C groups, thread splitting, so when we have a privilege thread and common thread for most actions that don't need privilege access. So this way we reduce attack surface on the system. We are using SOCOM isolation and process splitting. Why we need process splitting? Because unfortunately not all these technologies can be used together. For example, when SOCOM isolation is engaged and protect system call is banned. If you don't ban it, a malicious user can overcome SOCOM isolation. But when mProtect system call is banned, there is no way to create threats. So we have to use splitting by processes. It is much slower, but still it can work. So when we are talking about thread and performance, and thread splitting, we have some issues. Mutex implementation is not really good for high load locks. These graphs show difference in time between initial synchronization for simple implementation and threaded implementation. That's a problem, right? So how can we solve it? We can use spinlock instead of mutexes. But of course, spinlock cannot be used for long waits because it consumes full CPU core. And this dependency shows how initial synchronization time depends on number of iterations when spinlock has been used. It is quite natural that we should cut off spinlock usage somewhere here. And for large number of iterations, switch to mutexes. So we implemented this. It was not easy because, you know, there are many deadlocks when you are switching between threads, between spin locks and mutexes. We solved this. We implemented auto-adjustment of the point where program should switch from spin lock to mutex. And results are quite fine. You can see a yellow bar. It's quite close to simple non-trended implementation. That's really interesting result. So this application have more features because we have so many tasks for it. We implemented for regular expression support, we implemented control socket using Unix sockets. So several, well, that's in clustering, in management, in supporting for large infrastructure, this is quite important because you have socket control. And we implemented fast initial synchronization. Sometimes when we are starting system, we need to fastly synchronize one node with another without setting all watches on all subdirectories. Otherwise, it may take hours. This graph shows performance comparison between LSyncD, clsync daemon, and clsync in fast initial synchronization mode. Tests were done on, this is pure overhead values. Of course, real time is largely depending on your physical disk subsystems. This test was done on a memory file system in order to measure application overhead. Overhead in fast synchronization mode, it's green, it's almost zero, because we don't set all watches immediately. So it's quite, this saves time in real, in practice, makes a difference between minutes and hours on initial synchronization between different containers. So this, I have a few minutes left. These are examples of usage. Simple usage to mirror directory, just call insert rsync directly, watch some path and run rsync for destination path. All arguments for rsync will be automatically generated. This is example of one-time synchronization, so if one needs to make a relevant copy of another service. Quite interesting example, not related to rsync usage, is fixed permissions of huge website where developers, web developers, upload often files with incorrect permissions. So we are running CHON here on such aggregated events. And they are fixed immediately. That's when you have millions of files, you can just run CHON recursively. It will take too long time. And the solutions works well. If there are many subdirectories, there is a limitation in Linux kernel. Default value of the number of user watches is limited to 8,000. Right? And if you need more, you need to adjust this value using sysctl call. That's not a bug, that's just what kernel defaults are. So at this moment, the software is fully supported in Gentoo, in Debian. We also have spec files and FreeBSD ports available, but in Gentoo we right now supported only on MD64 and x86 architectures. We have no support on FBSD arches. We just don't use them in our use cases, so this support is not present for now. The only dependency which is mandatory is glib, so it's quite light with application. Well, these are our contacts, acknowledgements for our source, and thank you for attention. Any questions? Okay.